today. Father God, in the name of Jesus, truly I do thank and praise your name for your goodness and your mercy. Thanking you for your love and your tender kindness, dear God. I ask God that you will have your way on this morning, even as I bring forth the word of God. Lord, I ask that you will speak unto your people, Lord God, for you know the needs of your people. Asking God that you will touch each and every one in this room, that they will leave out, Lord God, a different way that they came in, knowing that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you ask or think of him. I ask that you will bless and have your way in this house. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. Those of you who have your Bibles, I ask that you will get them and turn with me to Mark, the 5th chapter, and we're going to begin reading at the 25th verse. That's Mark 5 and 25. I will be reading from the NIV Bible, so it's going to be a little different from what you have if you have the King James Version. And it reads, "And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 20 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in a crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, 'If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed.' Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, 'Who touched my clothes?' 'You see the people crowded against you,' his disciples answered, 'and yet can you ask, who touched me?' But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, 'Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be free from your suffering.'" I will use for a topic on this morning, how bad do you want it? You may be seated. How bad do you want it? I want to go back up to the 21st verse, because a lot of times we talk about the woman with the issue of blood, but there was two miracles happening at the same time. And there was a man who was a ruler named Jairus, who had a lot of power, who had money, who had authority, but at the same token, he had no power to heal. And so as he saw Jesus getting off the boat, he ran up to Jesus and said, "Jesus, my daughter is sick unto death." And he wanted Jesus to go with him to his house, because that's where his daughter was. And so Jesus said, "Okay, follow me and believe as you go." But then in the midst of that, I believe that the woman with the issue of blood was in the midst and heard what had happened. And in that moment, she probably thought, "Wow, look at little old me. And this great man with so much power asking Jesus to heal his daughter. This man had all the money in the world, but could not heal his own child." And here she was with nothing, going to doctors after doctors, losing all that she had just because she wanted healing. And so sometimes that's what we will do. We will do everything that we can before we go to Jesus. And so this young lady, anonymous, no name, decided that in the state that she was in, that she would push through the crowd to get to Jesus. Now understand this, there's a crowd, and here I am, weak in my body, trying to get to Jesus. And I'm sure that there were those who say, "Get back, don't touch him. Who are you? What is that smell that I'm smelling?" But the lady said, "In spite of, I got to get to Jesus." And so if you really go back into the days of Leviticus, in the book of the 15th chapter of Leviticus, if you had a situation like this young lady, you weren't allowed amongst the people. Because if you were even in the midst of the people, or even touched the people, they were considered unclean as well as you were unclean. But see, this woman said, "I don't care what they say, and I don't care what the law might say. My thing is, I got to get to Jesus." And so even though she did what she did, she probably had bruises all on her. People pushing, those who thought that they should have been in up with Jesus before they were. And then all of a sudden, see, he had some disciples that were around too. And a lot of times people say, why the man of God got security around? The same thing with Jesus. He had his disciples who was really his security, because they understood what Jesus wanted, but not at all times did they understand. Because at this moment, this woman was trying to get to Jesus. And so she touched just his clothes. All those people. A little nobody. Name not even mentioned in the Bible. A little nobody just touched the hem of Jesus' garment. And when she began to touch the hem of his garment, it wasn't the fact that she touched the hem. It was the fact that she had faith enough to touch him. And so when she began to touch the hem of his garment, she knew in a moment. It said it happened immediately. It wasn't no, it took time. It was immediately she began to realize that I'm healed. And she began to feel certain places that she knew that wasn't feeling too good. And then she said, wait a minute. I can't say nothing. So I'm sure after she got the healing, she began to back up. And she began to hide within the midst of a crowd. But Jesus knew what had happened. He said, wait a minute, wait a minute. He said, wait, somebody done touched me. He said, somebody done touched me. And so his smart disciples said, wait a minute, Jesus. All these people around you. And you know they done touched you somewhere. And you're going to say, somebody touched me. He said, but this touch was a little different. This touch took something out of me. And so when Jesus began to ask, and he looking around, and the young lady came forth, she said, it was me, Jesus. And Jesus said, go your way, daughter. Your faith has made you whole. He didn't say because you touched me made you whole. It was just her faith that made her whole. And so when I look at her, it was how bad do you want it? It was bad enough that she said, I don't care what you think about me. And I don't care how much it hurts. Whatever it takes for me to get to my Jesus, I'm going to do it. But then remember, I started out with Jairus at the beginning. Let's see what happened. And so even as she began to be healed by God, Jairus still hadn't received his miracle. And so somebody from his place said, Jairus, ain't no need of you asking Jesus to come. Your daughter's already dead. And so Jesus had to whisper in his ear, continue to believe in me. Sometimes when you're going through something and you're sick, you get around the wrong person. They will give you the wrong information. And there's no way that you'll be healed. But see, what you have to do is you have to learn how to stay focused and keep moving. So Jairus knew who he was with. I'm with the healer. And so Jairus began to walk with Jesus. And when he got to his house, sure enough, the daughter was dead. But guess what happened? The people in the city begin to cry, and Jesus can't take negative stuff because he's a positive God. And so he said, show me where she is. But while I'm going in, I want all of y'all to get out. Those who's crying, those who's weeping, those who thinking negative, those who can't see that I'm able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask for. Get up out of here. He said, you in the wrong place. That's right, you in the wrong place. But let me tell you, get out so I can do my work. And so even if they were put out, God, Jesus said, come on, mother, and come on, father, go with me into the house because I believe that you want your child alive. And so majority of the time, it's always those that want will believe, and those that don't want can't believe. So he said, get out. Y'all are in, let me begin to pray. But he didn't have to pray. He went right up to the daughter. He said, she's not dead. She's just asleep. And some things in our life we think is dead. It's not dead. It's just asleep. And all you need, even as his daughter, he went to her and grabbed her hand and said, get up. And she got up. Sometimes what you have to do is allow Jesus to come into your dead places that is really only asleep and grab it and bring it back alive. So you got to understand, it's how bad do you really want it? How bad do you want to be delivered? How bad do you want to be healed? How bad do you want to be set free? The choice is yours. But see what we do, we get around the wrong people. Going in the wrong direction, telling you that it can't be done because it didn't happen for them. But understand, with something God has for you, you gotta believe for yourself. Nobody can believe for you. But then let me go back a little bit. When I think about Jairus, guess what he did? He stood in proxy for his daughter. His daughter couldn't come up there because she was sick. Some people in your family might can't get to the house of God. But you can stand in proxy for them because of your faith. That they can be delivered. That they can come out of prison. That they can be healed. But it's up to us. Because it's really how bad do you want it? So you got to ask your neighbor. Say, neighbor, how bad do you want it? And some of them just looked at you and said, But when you want something bad enough, if I came in the house of God and I wanted healing, I don't care where I'm sitting or who's around me or who's trying to stop me to get to where I gotta get to, if I want it bad enough, guess what? I'm coming up there to get it. I don't have to get nobody to push me, cry me, shove me, go and get me. If I want it bad enough, I'm going to get it. So when you say how bad is bad. See, one time what we would do, we would say, I really want healing, but yeah, go ahead, Sister Sheila. I'm scared. How they gonna look at me? I don't look too good right now. And I'm hurting in my body. And I'm aching and this is happening and that's happening. But you know, would you want it bad enough? I might come in here limping, but going back out walking straight, that's how bad I want it. I might come in here confused, but God regulate my mind, that's how bad I want it. I might go out and come in here broke, but go out there with riches, that's how bad I want it. That's how bad I want it. I might even cry for it, but I want it. Because whatever God gives me, it's always good. He don't do nothing bad, nothing wrong. He does it great. So understand, don't come in the house of God waiting for somebody to push you up there to the altar. Waiting for somebody to push you to be baptized. Waiting for somebody to push you to be saved. How bad do you want it? There's no need for me to go into the hospital without wanting some service done to me. That'll be crazy. I'm just going to the hospital just to see how many people are there. That's all. Oh, let's see how many doctors are there today. But when I go into the hospital, I go in there for service. So when I come into the house of God, I came in here for service. I didn't come in here to look at you, nor to talk to you, but I got something bad that I need, that I got to get to my Jesus. I'm having trouble on every side, and you think I came here to talk to you? No, I came here to get what I want, because I know my Jesus got it. That's how bad I want it. I don't care if you don't want yours. If God want to give me yours too, I'll take yours. But that's how bad I want it. See, you got to understand. People get mad because they can't get theirs. And so what they do, if they can't get theirs, they'll be the main one to sit by you. So you won't get yours. And that's all they do is keep whispering in your ear. That's right, Pastor, distracting you. And you can't hear nothing, can't feel nothing, and end up don't want nothing. But when you get by somebody that wants something from God and needs something from God, it doesn't matter, I'm going to get mine. Hate on me if you want. Doesn't matter. Because see what it is, God wants everybody to be healed. He really does. And some he will and some he won't. Some there's a time and a season for everything. And so what happens when you get in the house of God and you really want God to do something, you want to be delivered, you want to be set free. Let me tell you, when you said what you said at home, I'm going out to the house of God and God's going to bless me. You wasn't in that room by yourself. The enemy heard you. See, the enemy don't know your thoughts. He only know what you say out of your mouth. And so when you said out of your mouth, I'm going to the house of God and I'm going to get my miracle. He said, no, you not. Because I got a sister there waiting for you. Or a brother. And they're going to pluck your nerve that you don't focus on nothing but what they done to you. Hey, so what happens is, God said, there's a setup for you, baby. Find yourself. Don't be intimidated that you can't move because somebody keeps talking to you. And they'll look at you and say, why she moved? It's because I want something. And it's not you. So I move so I can receive what God has for me. See, we use the house of God sometimes as a social club. And so when you socialize, you go back out socializing. But if I come in here praising him, I'm going back out praising him. So the thing about it, when I came in the door, I had some problems on my mind. But as I began to enter into the house of God, something kept saying, how bad do you want it? How bad do you want to be free? How bad do you want to hear the word of God? How bad do you want God to touch you? How bad do you want to just feel the presence of God? He said, he that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be what? Filled. And so when you come in here, you wanting something from God. When they say come to the altar, the first thing people are going to do, and this is normal, they're going to look. Who's coming? What they have on? What they coming up there for? And you're saying, do I have to tell them what I want? Do I have to tell them what's going on? No. Because some things you have to. If you want healing, you can ask for healing. You don't have to say what the healing is, but you can ask for it. So what you do, don't let the person next to you, no matter how many people on that row and where you're sitting. Did you understand what the lady did? She pushed through the crowd. Sometimes you gotta push through the saints of God and get what you want from God. Because see, God didn't bring you to the house of God just to bring you here. He brought you here for a purpose. And so when you begin to say to yourself now, it doesn't matter what anybody else says, say it to yourself, how bad do I want? How bad? Because understand, throughout the rest of the week, the enemy is coming at you. So how bad do I need that anointing from God? And how bad do I want God to show up and take me where I need to go? How bad? I want it so bad. So bad that I can taste it. so bad that I can see it, so bad that I can feel it, so bad just knowing that it's already done. And that's what the lady was doing. If you could just have that faith within you and say, no matter what it takes, I'm going to get mine. I'm going to get mine. If I have to walk alone, I'm going to get mine. I'm going to get mine. High five your neighbor and say, I'm going to get mine. Don't matter what it takes, I'm going to get mine. You better bet it. That's right. I'm going to get mine. And guess what? I don't have to wait to get it. Understand this, when you know who God is. See, in the days of old, God was on the outside of people. Today, where's Jesus? If he's on the inside of me, and I got the power on the inside of me, what am I waiting for to get what I want? What I'm waiting for? He said, you shall have power to lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. We just don't know who we are. You don't know. You don't know how much power you have because you get intimidated. Oh, this person been saved for a long time, so they got it. They got that power. And I just got saved. Do I have any power? You have power. You just might not have the knowledge of what you have, but you have the power. So what you have to understand is, if I don't have the power and I'm up in here, how bad do I want what they got? You got to live a life that people want what you got. That's what it is. If you can live a life, people will want what you have. But if you live poor like the rest of other people, they don't have to know where you live, but you tell them, oh, I live with the rats and the roaches. Oh, I never knew it until you told me. I thought you was rich. I thought you had it like that. And see, that's what we have to do. Change the mentality. Change our mentality to understand that God wants us to have everything we want, everything we desire. And so when you change your mindset to that point, I'm saying, how bad do I want it? That just sounds so good, don't it? How bad do I want it? Just say that with me. How bad do I want it? Ooh, how bad do I want it? It's just like when you want a car. I want that car so bad. Oh, are they going to give me a discount? I really want that car. That's the one I want right there. I'll do whatever it takes for me to get that car. Whatever it takes. Then when you get it, they be like, ooh, look what happened. That's a testimony. And so the same thing when it comes to God. How bad do you want the joy of God? How bad do you want the peace of God? How bad do you want the anointing of God? See, because we ask and get excited about the natural things. What about the spiritual things? Because it's those spiritual things that's going to keep you when you get the natural things. Because to whom much is given, much is what? Required. So how bad do you want it? It's going to be determined. It's going to depend on you. How bad? How bad do you want to praise God? How bad do you want to praise God? Listen to what I said. I said, how bad do you want to praise God? I want to praise God so bad, I don't have to wait on no music. That's how bad I want to praise God. Praise him right now. Why I gotta wait on music? I don't have to. But how bad do I want to praise him? It's how bad. How bad? How bad do I want to get in his presence? Because it's in the presence of the Lord. It's the fullness of joy. And in his right hand there are blessings forevermore. How bad do I want it? just that bad. So guess what? Nobody gonna push you down here to the altar. Nobody gonna push you to get a miracle. How bad do you want it? Because if I wanted it just that bad, and if I was feeling bad in my body, I'll be like, I can't wait till she finished preaching. That's how bad I want it. I'll come up here for healing now. That's how bad I want it. And so that's how we have to get when we come into the house of God. Stop allowing the enemy to control us and we control him. Let him get mad, because the reason why he's mad is because we're doing something that he used to do. And he can't do it no more. And that's how bad he might want it. So saints of God, those who are not saints of God, those who want to be saved, come down to the altar. Nobody gonna come back there to get you. It's how bad do you want it? How bad do you want your healing? How bad do you want to be delivered and set free? It's how bad do you want it? And so if you want to be touched by God, you want to be healed and set free, come on down right now. The altar is open. Because God does have a miracle for somebody in this house. I will tell people everywhere I go that God is a healer. He healed me of sarcoidosis 25 years ago, and I'm supposed to be dead. He's a healer. How bad do you want your healing? Anybody sick in their body, come forth. Healing is in this place right now. Healing. There's nothing that God can't do, only if you allow him.